Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
My name is Manshu Tyagi and I am teaching this course on heat and mass transfer. Today we will be starting lecture number 15, which is the continuation of the first part of the convection, which is introduction to convection part 3. Let us go ahead and see what we did in lecture number 14 last time. So earlier we had defined parameters which are linked to convection heat transfer like Nusselt number and Prandtl number. So, last time we have looked at some powerful equations which simplify greatly all the complexities of convection heat transfer, and we started looking at concepts like velocity boundary layer, which is shown in the blue color over here. We also looked at the critical Reynolds number, and there were some questions we had not answered. So, we have put lot of question marks over here. So, today we would like to look at them. That, for instance, what is the thickness of this particular boundary layer, how much shear stress does it exert on the flat plate, how much drag force does it apply, and so on. And similar questions will also come for the thermal boundary layer. So, here the thickness we are denoting also as delta x, but with a subscript t, and over here we will also have certain amount of questions. For instance, what is the thickness of this particular boundary layer, what is the value of h, what is the value of Nusselt number, how much is the overall heat transfer taking place from this hot plate to the air. So, all these things we have to figure out. So, this is what we will try and do today, and we also looked at the similar concept for the flow inside a pipe. So, we looked at the entrance region and the fully developed region. So, today we want to answer certain questions that we have raised earlier. Before we do that, one small deviation we will take, because we want to look into the details of the convection differential equations. So, let me go ahead and start with that particular topic, because this will help us understand how we will be able to obtain the answer to those questions. So, we will look at differential convection equations, and these are essentially going to be conservation of mass, momentum, and the energy balance equation. So, I think I am going to assume that some background students are having in this particular area. So, I will not go into too much detail, rather I will start with the results that I will show over here. So, in a two dimensional form, the differential analysis, it gives this kind of result for the continuity equation or conservation of mass. So, over here what I am assuming is the velocity profile in the vector form I can write as it is u I plus v j plus w k. So, I am going to assume it is a two dimensional flow, because that is how things will turn out in many cases. It could be a flow over a flat plate over here. So, we get a flow like this. So, velocity v component is also there, but it is very small, and of course, w is 0. We will also look at flow between two plates. So, this one will move at velocity 0 at some velocity v. The bottom one is fixed, velocity 0. So, we will find out that some sort of a velocity profile we will see in this direction over here. We may also see pressure driven flow, del p by del x negative, between two flat plates, both of them will be fixed. So, in this case we will see some sort of a parabolic flow profile over here. So, these are all examples of two dimensional flows. So, what we are going to look at over here is this simplified version of the conservation of mass or the continuity equation. We can call it both. So, I can call it COM, which stands for conservation of mass, or I can also call it continuity equation. Then we have the momentum equation in x direction. Which I can write. So, momentum equation we can look at the derivation that I will not be performing in this particular lecture over here, but it essentially starts with the Newton's second law. We just write force equals to mass into acceleration, then for a small fluid element we can figure out all the forces which are acting on it, the shear forces on the sides, then the normal forces, it could be also be body forces, and all of that is equivalent to the acceleration of that particular differential element. And if you go through that whole exercise, what we get is in the simplified form, what we get is something like this. This is del p by del x. Okay. And finally, what we can do is we can go ahead and write the energy balance equation. And this one will be slightly longer. So, it starts with rho Cp u del t del x plus v del t u del y is equals to k del square t del x square del square t del y square plus mu into phi, where phi is defined in the next equation as follows. Phi is known as, by the way, this is known as the viscous dissipation term. Or the viscous dissipation function, and is given by this particular equation over here. So, these are the three equations, let me highlight them with the red stars. This is equation number 1, this is equation number 2, and these two put together is equation number 3 over here. So, we have mass, momentum and energy equation, and this whole thing we are doing for the differential approach. Now, if some student is approaching them for the first time, again I would say that revise some basics about the fluid mechanics, because that is kind of a prerequisite for heat and mass transfer. And if you have already looked at it somewhere before, but you are not, it has been a long time since you looked at it. One way to get familiar with complicated equations is to look at certain examples. So, one example that I could think of is this example over here. And it is kind of this kind of a flow over here known as the Couette flow, where the fluid is present between two parallel plates. So, let me draw very long plates over here. So, this is the first plate and this is the second plate, and throughout the fluid is present in between. Now, it is the condition is such that this plate is moving with 0 velocity, in as a matter of fact it is stationary, the bottom plate is stationary, and the top plate is moving towards the right with velocity v, and this value is known to us. I will put the coordinate system over here. So, this is my x direction, this is my y direction. Both the plates are maintained at some constant temperature Ts. So, the bottom plate and the top plate, so I will call this as the top plate, this is the bottom plate, both are maintained at a uniform temperature Ts. So, what do we want to find in this particular problem are as follows. So, what I want to find first is the velocity profile of the fluid. Second, what is the temperature profile of the fluid? And third, how much heat is going in or out from the top and the bottom surfaces. So, what are some of the things that are known to me? I will put them over here. So, all dimensions are known to me. Both the plates are extremely long. So, the bottom plate is very large, the top plate is very large. So, we can assume that the whole flow is in the z direction. We can assume all the parameters are not changing. The distance between the plates is also known to us, and everything about the fluid is known to us. So, for instance, if it is some sort of oil, I know its density, I know its specific heat, I know its thermal conductivity and also its viscosity as well. So, what I want to do is solve for these three parameters, and I thought of doing this exercise because I wanted to become familiar with these equations and figure out how do I actually use them in real life. So, let us start with the first step, which is we will use the conservation of mass equation or the continuity equation. So, if you go back on the previous slide and write that equation over here, so what do we get is del u by del x plus del v by del y is equals to 0. And what we get over here is that because it is kind of a one dimensional flow, there is no velocity because both the plates are solid, they are not allowing any fluid movement in the vertical direction. So, the v component is 0. So, I can make this particular term go to 0 and I can give the explanation because throughout v is 0, which gives me del u by del x equals to 0. So, what does this first equation tell me? That u is only a function of, it is not a function of x because the partial derivative for that is actually 0, this is equals to 0. So, what it means is that u is simply a function of y, which means over here I can go back to my diagram on the top and kind of say that whatever is the velocity profile over here, if I draw it like this, it may or may not be correct, we will figure it out. If this is the velocity profile at this value of x, it will remain the same throughout. So, even if I can draw it over here, then over here also it will remain the same. So, this analysis tells me that this velocity profile is irrespective of the value of x, it could be x1 or x2. If it is not changing from x1 to x2, it will remain the same for all x. That is what is the significance of this equation over here. Now, let us go on and look at the next equation. So, I will look at step 2. So, this was step 1 earlier. Now, we will go and look at step 2. So, let us apply the momentum equation. And once I do that, if I try to write that, this is density multiplied by u by del x plus v del u by del y is equals to mu del square u del y square minus del p by del x. Now, let us try and see, are there some ways in which I can simplify this momentum equation. So, let us go term by term. Density is some finite number. So, I will leave it as a constant over here. What about u? U I know is a function of y. So, this term is okay, but if u is only a function of y, then del u by del x becomes 0. This is equals to 0. And I can give the explanation because u is only a function of y, that is it. So, the first term becomes 0. What about the second term? This part is non-zero. but the first part is 0 because V is equals to 0. Okay. Now, the first term on the right hand side we will leave at as it is because it looks like it may not be 0. What about the last term over here? So, experience tells us that in this type of a flow we will not be able to need for putting any fan, blower or pump over here in order to make the fluid flow. So, usually whenever some fluid is flowing, we can immediately see that there must be some force which is actually acting on it, and usually that force is provided through some fluid machine in the form of, it could be a pump, it could be a blower, it could be a compressor, it could be a fan which consumes electricity or mechanical work, and then that pushes the fluid forward. So, it is giving some momentum or adding some momentum to it. That is one way. Another way is that we do not have any machine or any other device, but gravity could be doing the same thing. So, that can happen in this room, it can happen at the city level, it could happen on the planet level as well. So, we see at various places in continents, hurricane, typhoon, cyclones, etcetera, those kind of things take place. So, that is because of the differential heating of the land and of the ocean and various other complicated phenomena which can make the air and vapor and other things rise if they are hot. So, that is another way in which it can go, but in this particular problem, because the top plate is actually being moved with some velocity v, we do not have to have any effect of gravity, we do not need to put any fan over here. So, I will cross it out over here, I do not need any fan or blower or anything. So, in these kind of cases we can immediately see that it is not a pressure driven flow, which means del p by del x won't be a finite quantity, it will be a 0. So, we make this simplification over here and what we get as a result is simply del square u by del y square is equals to 0. So, this is what I get from the momentum equation. So, it is a second order differential equation. How do I solve it? So, I think this part we can do very quickly. It will just simply turn out to be a function of y, and I can write it with the help of these two constants over here. So, I think this is something we have been doing quite a lot since we are looking at conduction and solving the second order ordinary differential equation. So, how do we find these two constants? So, I think again students who are following from conduction onward, we need two boundary conditions. And what are those boundary conditions over here? So, I need help from students that what are these two boundary conditions in terms of velocity. So, if we look around the y direction, because that is where it is changing, can we say something about the velocity along the y direction? The velocity in x direction, its variation in y direction, sorry it sounds little confusion, because u, remember u is the velocity in x direction. So, I kind of misspoke earlier. So, what is the velocity in x direction at the bottom over here? If I look at this red dot over here, can I apply no slip condition? So, the answer is yes. So, I will say at y equals to 0, which is the first layer of fluid sitting next to the bottom plate, I can immediately say here the velocity will be 0. So, the velocity at y equals to 0 has to be 0, and this will be my boundary condition number 1. And how do I justify it? So, remember from previous lecture, we have talked about the no slip condition, where the solid actually convinces the first atom or molecule or very thin layer of fluid to actually attain its own velocity. So, if the solid is at rest, then that particular layer remains at rest. So, there is no slip between them. And what is the next boundary condition I can write at y equals to L? Can I also apply the no slip condition here? So, answer is yes, wherever the solid and liquid are actually in contact, if all the surfaces over here on the shirt, on the pen, everywhere, that solid convinces the fluid to attain its own velocity. So, when the pen starts moving, so the first layer of the fluid over here is also moving with the same velocity, because they both will have no slip, zero slip between them. So, if the top layer is moving with velocity v over here, then we can say immediately u as y equals to L is simply capital V. So, this capital V is known to us, this is some number, and this is my boundary condition number 2. So, what I am going to do is apply these two boundary conditions over here and I will get the value of C1 and C2. So I can do it, I think, very quickly. If we apply the first boundary condition, we become make it 0. So whatever we get is C2 equals to 0. Immediately we will get that. If we apply the second boundary condition, left hand side becomes V is equals to C1 into L. So this gives me C1 is V by L, which means my equation final solution turns out to be, this is equals to V into Y by L, that is it. So, I will put a green star over here, this is the solution that I have got for velocity. Now, we go back to the figure that I had drawn earlier, maybe with green ink I can actually show, so what we have drawn earlier was correct. So, this is a linear profile that we will get over here. And the length of these arrows actually kind of indicate the velocity of the fluid. So, the magnitude is shown, the direction is also shown, that is we have put an arrow over there. So, the fluid velocity is 0 at the bottom and the fluid velocity is capital V at the top, because it is moving along with the solid surface. So, we have used two of these equations over here, continuity and momentum equation. Now, let us go ahead and use the energy balance equation. So, it is a long equation. Let me write it quickly so that we can simplify it quickly as well. So, the first term turns out to be rho Cp u del T del x plus V del T del y is equals to k del square T del x square del square T del y square plus mu phi over here, which is the viscous dissipation term. So, now let us try and see if I can simplify this equation over here. So, can we do it quickly? Answer is yes, velocity is 0, so this whole thing becomes 0. First term we will come back in a little while. Okay, let us do first term. What do we think about first term? This is non-zero, u is non-zero, but what about del t by del x? What it is asking is, at any given y, what is the differential of dt by dx? What is the temperature gradient along the x direction? Now, if the plates are very, very long, then we can say that all gradients in x direction are negligible, because it is an infinitely long plate. If it is a small plate, then things will start, they will become steady, then they will end, then there is no, then the gradient will be there. If it is a thin plate, then again it will be there. But if it is infinitely long, that then middle stable period is remaining throughout, which means we are in that zone where del t by del x is actually 0. So, I will make it 0. If it is 0, second order is also 0, sorry. So, del square t by del x square also becomes 0. So, we only have one term over here and then we have also this thing over here. So, let us also solve for phi. So, phi I will write over here. So, this is a viscous dissipation function. And this value we can write from two slides back. So, I am writing it from my notes and it turns out to be this plus one more term plus this whole square. So, this also we can simplify very quickly. So, with the logic which I had just mentioned, I will make this also 0, because nothing changes with x, all gradients with x are 0. So, this also becomes 0. Then del v by del y I can also make 0, because velocity by itself was 0. So, from here all I get is this term over here. So, I will put a green circle on this term and the green circle on this term, because these two equations are essentially one. I will just plug back in the value of capital phi and let us see what do we get. So, over in this equation, on the top equation, left hand side is 0, right. Then the first term on the right hand side is simply k del square t del y square, because everything else is 0, that is the beauty over here. Then we only have this last term over here, which is mu into phi, and again in phi all terms are 0 except for this one over here. So, what we get is del u by del y, but do not forget this square over here, because we have a square over here. So, this is the governing equation for our energy balance. How do I solve it? I will have to use some relationships and then treat it like ordinary differential equation and solve it. So, the first relationship I want to put it this one, because u as a function of y I have already solved. If you go back over here, we have solved u as a function of y. So, if somebody asks me what is del u by del y, I can directly say that del u by del y, because of my previous equation, is simply v by l. So, let me plug that in over here. So, what I get is 0 is equals to k del square t del y square plus mu v square by l square. Sorry, this is capital V square by l square. So, now it has become from a it's become very simple equation, and I will just integrate it twice and I will get certain constants. Let me go ahead and do that. Okay. So, once I'll move on to the new page. What I get over here is, so d square t dy square is equals to minus mu by k v square by l square. So, I integrate it once, I get dt by dy is equals to minus mu v square k l square y, plus I will put a constant, let me say constant d1. Then I integrate it one more time, then I get t as a function of y on the left hand side. So, the first term will become a square in terms of y. So, it becomes y square divided by 2 k l square. I hope I am doing it correct. Plus this becomes d 1 y plus there will be one more constant. So, please keep on checking whether there is any error in or solving this thing. Then we need to solve this thing. I think this is the final solution. Only thing we want to find out is the value of d1 and d2. So, again we need more, we need two boundary conditions in temperature. Earlier also we needed two boundary conditions, but they were in velocity. Okay. You remember u y we had also solved, there we wanted to solve for c 1 and c 2. Can I go back to previous slide just to illustrate this point? Now, I need two boundary conditions in temperature, and one wonderful thing is there that already in the problem two temperatures are given to us at the bottom and at the top. The top temperature is T s, bottom temperature is also T s. So, I will use these boundary conditions and I will say that I know that temperature at y equals to 0 is known to me as T s, and if I put y equals to 0 in this equation, what do I get is d 2. So, d 2 value we have figured out. The other we will figure out is if I put y equals to L, then also I get T s, and that value over here will be little bit long. So, I can write that expression mu v square. Y square I will replace with L square because I am using L, and 2 k L square both will get cancelled, plus d 1 L plus T s, sorry. So, T s gets cancelled with T s. From here I will get the value of d 1 and I can plug that in. Once I plug that in, I have the final result over here. So, let me see, d 1 value turns out to be something like mu v square 2 k L. Please check this expression, and then finally, if you plug that in over there, then we get temperature value T y is equals to T s plus mu v square divided by 2 k and L by y, L square, y square by L square. So, this is the final solution that we were looking for. I put a star over here, this is the final solution, and this gives me the temperature throughout that particular fluid. And what is it a function of? It is a function of T s, which is something which were known to us. Then fluid property is mu, k, and the flow property velocity. It is function of the length or the height or the distance between the two flat plates, and it is the only variable over here is y. So, I can keep on changing y and I can get the value of t. What I would like to do is draw this particular profile over here, but I don't find any space. So let me move on to the next slide over here. So I will draw these two flat plate over here again. So what I am seeing is, let me draw the temperature profile. If the temperature here is Ts, so if I represent the temperature with length, but I will not put any arrows. So in middle we will have high temperature, something like this, and then at each point I know the temperature just because of the by measuring the length of these lines. So if I put the axis over here, this is x, this is y, and this length represents Ts over here, and at middle the temperature is T max. Now because of shortage of time, I won't be solving the q dot value, but I'll just give the expression and I can show the direction. So if between two plates, if lot of heat generation is taking place and the middle point is the one which is having maximum temperature, which means half of the heat will go from the top, half of the heat will come out from the bottom, which means I can put those things over here, that q dot top will be like this and q dot bottom will be like this. Let me go ahead and figure out the expression for q dot top. So I can always write heat transfer at all places. It's simply k a del t by del y. The location is y equals to m. So all I need to do is differentiate it once over here, this particular equation, plug that in over here, and I will get that expression. So maybe instead of q dot top, I will say the flux at top, which is q dot top divided by A, and that expression I have calculated, and students may actually check, it turns out to be this. So this is in watts per meter square. And I can also write for q dot bottom the same thing we will get, with the only difference it will be a negative sign v square upon, and this is also in watts per meter square. So I think with this particular exercise we have figured out two or three things. One real life example we have seen, that if flow is taking place between two plates, the bottom one is stationary, top one is moving at high speed, lot of heat generation takes place inside over here, and the best way that we can characterize is that the convection heat transfer is taking at the surface, it is coming out as conduction. A very interesting thing is going on over here. Now what we want to do is, we want to focus, after learning and revising these three equations, continuity of mass, continuity equation, momentum equation, energy equation. Now we want to go and address all these question marks that we have written over here. So these three question marks we will try and find out, what is the value of H, Nusselt and Q, and before over here, what is the value of force, shear stress, then delta x, delta t x, all those solutions we want to find out, right? So we want to figure out that for the velocity boundary layer as well as for the thermal boundary layer, what are all those values. So solution for that will have the similar approach, but I am not going to go into the details of that solution because it is for advanced course. But what I want to tell is that the solution will come from these three equations itself, and the gentleman who came up with that solution, I'll give reference of that, that is Blasius. So this we are talking about is the Blasius solution. And what we are talking about is essentially delta x question mark, delta t x question mark. So we will remind ourselves, we are looking at the earlier case and we are restricting ourselves to the laminar portion of the boundary layer, and I want to figure out how does it actually vary. One hint I had given earlier, that the answer turns out to be square root of x, and this is credited to the scientist engineer known as Blasius, and he has given this particular solution. So let us look at this solution, which will help us understand how does it actually the thickness varies. Over here, according to Blasius' solution, what we obtain is this particular expression, and it is very simple and straightforward. like this. So, what it actually depends upon mainly is that the boundary layer thickness is actually increasing with the distance. So, if we see the typical square root curve, if I can draw over here on the right hand side, so we have always associated the parabolic curve, let us say y equals to x square, it goes something like this, it increases over here, this is a parabola. Now, I can draw the reverse thing in terms of square root. So, I can say that y equals to square root of x. So, any x value we take, and of course, it will come out to be plus and minus. So, something like this we will get. So, this is the boundary layer shape that we are seeing over here. So, I think students will be reminded that just revise some geometry in trigonometry and other correlations. Then what we are seeing over here is the expression for the boundary layer thickness, and this is the for the velocity boundary layer, and similar expression we can get for the thermal boundary layer. And it turns out that they are both linked with simply the ratio of Prandtl number to the power 1 by 3. So, Prandtl to the power 1 by 3 simply links the velocity boundary layer to the thermal boundary layer. So, the result turns out to be very beautiful, and we can see that in both cases it will turn out to be this square root region over here. So, y is equals to square root of x. Now, one thing I wanted to share with students, for that I did some calculation over here, that the way we are drawing all these diagrams, the way we are showing the boundary layer, and in many standard textbooks also when you read, the boundary layer is shown like that, but in real life the boundary layer is actually very, very thin. So, I want to give the real number, but for explanation purpose all teachers, all textbook, they draw it slightly larger, because it is easier for comprehension. So, if I have to draw it to real scale, it would turn out to be extremely thin. So, for doing that, let me take one example for air which is flowing over a flat plate. So, now I will pick some exact numbers, and for air it turns out if I have this particular velocity, temperatures I will consider is room temperature, let us say. So, this I am doing just to give to the students some feel that what kind of numbers are we looking at, and I can figure out what is the kinematic viscosity by looking at some tables from a standard textbook. So, maybe it is like 1.5 into 10 to the power minus 5, and the units is meter square per second, and for the same value Prandtl number is about 0.7 for air. So, these are values that I have obtained from a textbook, and what I want to do is I want to see how would the actual boundary layer look like at scale. So, let me calculate first the critical Reynolds number in this particular example over here. So, Reynolds number critical for a flat plate is approximately 5 into 10 to the power 5, and I would define it as V x by nu. So, from this particular expression I can calculate the x, the distance of the critical Reynolds number. So, let us say I represent it by this particular length over here. I can use it because in this equation velocity is known to me. Velocity is known to me as 1 meters per second, and nu value is known to me because that one I have taken from the table right over here. So, from here I can calculate the value of x critical for air, and it is approximately turning out to be about 7.5 meters. So, please keep on checking these numbers, because I am doing these calculations by hand, maybe some small mistake I might have made. Over here, if this length represents 7.5 meters, now I have this equation as well. On the left hand side, I am putting a red star over here, and this can give me the value of the right hand side over here. So, I can calculate that. So, it so turns out to be that this number at 7.5 meters, if my calculation is correct, is about 5 centimeters. So, if this whole length is 7.5 meter, over here is about 1 meter. So, 1 20th of 1 meter is, so this is, what I am trying to say is the height over here, this is about 5 centimeter height or even less than that. So, if the real boundary layer to scale, if I have to draw, then to student I want to show that it is will be even thinner than this one. So, in real life when you look at the boundary layer, it is extremely thin for long distances. Of course, if you are looking at in detail, then we can zoom in over there and have a effect. But even in this small thickness, the boundary layer is extremely thin. So, I will put the number over here. So, here delta x is about 5 centimeters. So, you can see after traveling a distance of 7.5 meter, that distance is 5 centimeter. If you reduce it 4 times, then the distance, the thickness reduces twice. So, in other words, if I assume it was 8 meters, reduce it 4 times, I am talking about 2 meters over here, then this thickness is about half. So, this thickness over here delta x is about 2.5 centimeters. So, these distances that we are talking are extremely small. Now, one good thing is we also have the Prandtl number over here, which means I can also calculate the thermal boundary layer. So, if I put that Prandtl number over here and take the power 1 by 3. So, over here at this particular point, I will write that value as well. So, thermal boundary layer at x equals to about 7.5 meters, it turns out to have a value of about, I am just giving rough value, about 6 centimeters or 5.5 centimeters over there. So, because Prandtl number value is less than 1 for air, which means thermal conductivity is slightly larger, if the thermal diffusivity plays a better, bigger role. So, maybe that thermal layer I will draw like this one over here. So, this exercise I am just doing to show the difficulty of showing the boundary layer in its actual form. So, that is why we have to zoom in and then show boundary layers like at very steep gradients we have to show, but in reality it is not like that. In reality it is more close to this. So, just keep this thing in mind while we are doing this particular analysis. So, two things we have been able to figure out of all those things which we had highlighted earlier in yellow, those question marks, that what is the boundary layer thickness for velocity boundary layer and what is the thickness for the thermal boundary layer. What were the other parameters that we wanted to figure out? The other parameter what we wanted to look at was how much force is exerted on that plate by the air. So, if the air is moving over here, because the plate is trying to slow down the air, the air is trying to pull the plate over there. So, just Newtonian mechanics, which means it will experience some sort of a force over here, and unless I apply a reactionary force R1 newtons on this particular side, which has to be equal to this force F, only then my plate will be stationary. If my R1 is less than F, then the plate will actually gradually move in the x direction. So, it will start moving over here if my R1 is less than F. So, this thing is important that we have to take. So, how will I figure out the value of F? So, for that I can write F is essentially, I will have to integrate, if I assume the length of this particular plate to be L, then I take a small section over here which is having this particular length dx, and in reality this plate will have the z direction also, because I need to figure out the area over here. So, I am just going to assume the width of the plate is some constant W, right. So, what I can do is I can try and write it in this form, that I will integrate force from 0 to L. So, I am integrating df, then I will get the value of F. So, this is the frictional force which is taking place over here. Can I write it in terms of the wall shear stress? So, if I write force is equals to, so over here differential area will be dA. So, I am integrating 0 to L, and what is dA in my case? I am just taking that strip of length dx multiplied by W. So, this small strip I am taking over here, and I am trying to figure out how much force is actually being exerted by the air on this strip, and then that expression once I get, I will integrate it throughout. So, I will substitute it over here. So, what I get is this is equals to tau W this is equals to tau w into capital W width multiplied by dx, and then I am integrated to 0 to L. So, width is a constant, it will come outside. So, what I will get is something like this. Now, I am interested in figuring out the value of tau w, and this is again something which is obtained from Blasius solution. So, the result for that I will write over here. So, according to Blasius, this wall shear stress, by the way, which definition says is it is equals to del u by del y at y equals to 0. Right. What we are talking about is, if I know the velocity profile over here, if this is my boundary layer, so we remember this is the velocity profile which becomes straight at this point and this point. So, we are talking about this slope over here. So, this slope at this particular point, this is del u by del y at y equals to 0. So, this is something that we are trying to plug in over here. So, Blasius gave the solution for this. And according to him, and his solution is true for laminar case only. So, whatever I am writing on the previous slide over here, so this is, please remember, this is for the laminar boundary layer, and for this case also we are talking about the laminar boundary layer. So, this expression, it turns out to be 0.332 capital velocity v, and then in square root we are writing rho mu, dynamic velocity of the fluid, v by x. So, essentially even the wall shear stress, I can put an x over here, and this I am writing x y because itself it is a function of x, it is a function of distance, which means as we go along the distance forward, the fluid is moving over the plate, it is experiencing different shear stress at different particular points. And the interesting thing is, it is varied by 1 by square root of x. So, the thickness of the boundary layer was varying with square root of x, the shear stress is actually varying with square root of inverse of x, inverse of the square root of x. So, what we are getting is very interesting result. I will also define over here one more parameter which makes life easy. This is the coefficient of friction. Which is a non-dimensionalized parameter, and it links this shear stress, it has been non-dimensionalized using this constant quantity half rho v. So, the denominator is easy to calculate because I know the capital V value over here, or capital V I am taking as u infinity, both are same, this is capital V. And over here density value we are already knowing. Which means, in other words, this I will continue over here. This tau w I can also convert into Reynolds number. How I can do that? I can write Reynolds number itself is a function of x, and I can say it is v into x divided by nu. If I can plug this value in over here, what I will get is 0.33332. rho v square divided by Reynolds x. So, these are some very interesting results that we are getting, and let me complete it by writing the value of the friction coefficient as well. And then friction coefficient definition we are seeing from here, this black star. So, all I do is take this thing which I have already calculated, tau w as a function of x, and divided by half rho v square. So, I think this thing we will get is very straightforward. It turns out to be 664 square root of r e x. So, I think up till this point we have figured out how things are working. Now, what we want to do is, we want to go back and figure out the value of f, because this, on this particular slide 13, whatever we are doing, all these details, ultimately we want to calculate the capital F, which means now I can plug in over here the value of tau w. Let me do that and do that integration, and then let us see what do we get. So, over here what we had was F equals to 0 to L, and capital W was outside the integral over here, and we have tau W into dx, and tau W I will directly write as 0.332 capital V square root rho mu V square, and the denominator is x and dx. And all these constant things over here that we are seeing, let me say over here, these are all the constants. What I am talking about, all these things are constants, which means I can write it as C. So, I will write over here that whole thing is C divided by square root of x into dx. Once I do this thing, then the answer which I get is very straightforward. It is C into this into F. So, this force I am able to obtain in terms of Newton, which means just by knowing the Blasius solution and knowing the free stream velocity, which is coming from the left hand side as u infinity or capital V, whatever I call it, and the length of the plate, I can figure out just by applying the assumption for laminar boundary layer that how much force, drag force will actually be acting on that. And this is the expression for that particular thing, and this we can look into more detail later on. But this is a very powerful equation, and the reason it is powerful is that from theory itself, Blasius was able to figure out, and those things have been verified experimentally that this is actually true, that that gives the credence to the boundary layer theory. That if we assume very small thickness, where you remember we have taken the velocity as 99% of that of the free stream velocity, and then we have tried to figure out that how does the velocity inside it vary, and now we will see how does the temperature inside it vary, because we have figured out the value of F, tau and delta for the velocity boundary layer. Let us also try to figure out what happens for these values once the same thing is taking place for a thermal boundary layer. And by thermal boundary layer, if you remember, we have taken that particular example where the plate was hot and the free stream velocity over here of air, this temperature of air we have taken as cold. So, can we also figure out using Blasius equation, because there is lot of similarity between momentum and heat and mass transfer. Just by looking at this expression, can we figure out these particular values for a given length of the plate? And the answer is yes. So, this is something, but it involves little bit calculation. So, I won't figure it, I won't complete it in this particular lecture. This is something I will do in the next lecture. So, once we meet in the next lecture, we will try and figure out the expression for all these particular variables, and the concept we will use, the procedure that we will use is exactly similar as the one we did for momentum, because whatever is the force which is applied on the flat plate, it is actually coming because of the exchange of momentum. And the same thing we will see for the thermal case, that whatever heat transfer will come, it will be the because of the temperature gradient. So, these things are actually come out to be exactly similar, and one hint for that I will tell over here, that how it is coming out to be similar is this expression over here, because we can see the thickness of the velocity boundary layer and the thermal boundary layer are just correlated by a constant Prandtl number. The second thing that we will see over here, if we go back two or three slides, this is something I wanted to ask earlier, but I will ask it now, that if we look carefully between the energy equation, the first energy equation, this one, and the momentum equation, do we see some similarity? So, if we see over here, u del t by del x, here u del u by del x, second term v del t by del y, v del u by del y. So, we see some sort of mathematical similarity in the first term, here also del square t del x square, here it is del square 2 del y square. So, very much similarity we are seeing, and this thing we will figure out later on, which help us tremendously in creating some analogies between the heat transfer and the momentum transfer. And those analogies also we will study in the next lecture. So, So with that, let me give a brief recap of what we have studied today. We have looked at the boundary layer in very much detail. So if we look at the thickness of the boundary layer for the thermal case and the thickness of the boundary layer for the velocity case, these are some of the things that we have looked at. Then we have also looked at the various equations, the continuity equation, momentum equation and energy equation. Then we had put lot of question marks that what are some of the extra things that we can learn from here, like what is the total force which is actually applied on the plate, what is the total heat transfer that we have applied. So some portion of that we have done today, the remaining thing we will do in the next lecture. So with that, I thank the students, we will meet again in next lecture. Thank you.